Sushruta for NEET is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
Good morning, students. In our last class, we have started this particular topic of alkaline earth metals, and we have then started also the chemical properties of alkaline earth metals. Now we will just be finishing this portion, and this portion I'll start with this hydrides of alkaline earth metals. We have seen oxides and other hydroxides of alkali earth metals, how they are formed, how are there some of their general properties, and also the standard reduction potential, reduction the solutions in liquid ammonia, many other things we have seen, hydration enthalpies and all. Now let us look at this hydrides of alkaline earth metals. Hydrides, you know, hydrides means the compounds with the hydrogen. So compounds of alkali metal with the hydrogen, and so what we know, the except beryllium, and we know usually that beryllium has certain properties which are different than that of other alkaline earth metals, and beryllium is also metal. So what we know, there are all metals in this group: beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, and barium, and then radon. So radon mostly we do not focus on because it is radioactive and its chemistry is not in our syllabus. So what we know about the hydrides, except beryllium, all alkaline earth metals form hydrides on heating directly with hydrogen. So all the alkaline earth metals except beryllium, means the magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium, radium I am not talking about, because radium chemistry is not there in our syllabus. So they all form hydrides, and they all form ionic hydrides. So M plus H2, M is the metal, M means magnesium, calcium, strontium, and barium, it forms MH2. MH2 is the molecular formula of the hydride of this ionic hydride of alkaline earth metals. This molecular formula you can also consider, you cannot call it as a molecular formula because this is not a simple molecule if it is ionic. And why it is, if it is ionic, it is not a molecule? Because we have seen molecules are formed only because of the covalent bonds. And where there is a discrete molecule that forms like water, water is a molecule, it has a separate entity. H2O exists separately. But usually what we see in the case of ionic compounds, we see one cation is surrounded by many anions and one anion surrounded by many cations in the crystal structure and so on. So there is no separate existence of one cation and one anion pair usually in the solid state. You might get such things in the solution, and that we call there as ion pair. So that is a different story. So ion pairs might be formed in solution, and that, but those ion pairs are usually surrounded by many of the water molecules. The cation is surrounded by many water molecules, and ion is also surrounded by many water molecules, and if their concentration of this salt is quite high. So sometimes what happens is cations and anions, they come closer, and they come so closer that it appears that they are interacting, they have formed a bond. So these kind of things are called ion pairs, and that is why what we have seen, the concentration sometimes is not equal to activity. What is the, so that activity term that comes. So anyway, let's not go into that detail. We have seen those things to a certain extent in ionic equilibrium and other things. So what do we see here is magnesium, calcium, strontium, and barium, they all directly react with hydrogen to form hydrides. They are ionic hydrides, and the hydrides, we know how many types of hydrides can be there, so this we have studied in chemistry of hydrogen. However, the beryllium hydride can be formed with the help of lithium aluminium hydride. And what can you see here is beryllium, this is the hydrogen, and hydrogen electropositive character increases down the group. So beryllium has least electropositive character, and what we have also seen, its reduction potential is also highest. So if you look at the value, it's in the negative it is lowest, and in the negative it is lowest. So it means, what does it, its reduction potential means the potential to reduce other is also less. So it doesn't have its potential to itself reduce this hydrogen, because in this what we have seen, this metal is in plus oxidation state and the hydrogen is minus one oxidation state. So the potential of beryllium itself is not enough so that it can break hydrogen bond, or the single bonds between two atoms. We have seen earlier that hydrogen bond is the strongest bond. whether it is FA bond, CL bond, BRBR bond, II bond, all the single bonds between two atoms, what we have seen usually by the same type of atoms, means between homo atoms, if the diatomic molecules are there, then what we see, this hydrogen has the strongest bond. So beryllium doesn't have that much potential so that it can directly break the hydrogen bond, or it can reduce hydrogen directly to MH2. But what we see, if the hydrides are there in certain forms, where hydrogen is already there in the form of hydride, H minus kind of thing, so there we can see such a molecules and we can form BeH2. And what we see, this BeCl2 beryllium chloride is there. Beryllium is already in the oxidized form, and the hydrogen is in the form of hydride. It's lithium aluminium hydride. So this is Li plus and AlH4 minus. AlH4 minus is nothing but AlH3 plus H minus. So there we have H minus, and that H minus actually can be replaced. And so there will be double displacement reaction. So the hydride will go to beryllium and the chlorine will come here. So the finally we can form the beryllium hydride as well. So beryllium hydride will form by other means, not by direct reaction with the hydrogen. Plus LiCl, then LiCl will be there. Lithium will react with chlorine, and then AlCl3 will also be separated. AlCl3, we know it's a Lewis acid, this kind of compound we have seen. It has certain similarity with the BeCl2 in some cases. Those things we'll see a bit later. So beryllium hydride, magnesium hydrides are covalent, and while other hydrides are ionic. And why these hydrides are covalent, that you know, because these are very smaller cation, a small size cation. They have two dipositive charge, plus two charge on both beryllium and magnesium, these cations, and the hydride is there. And because of the positive charge, you know, because of and the Poisson's rule, you see some polarization will happen, a polarization of the electron cloud of hydrogen. So this electron cloud will be sitting between beryllium and hydrogen, and whatever is sitting between them, that we can consider as a sharing between that much electron effectively is shared between beryllium and hydrogen or magnesium and hydrogen. So this beryllium hydride and magnesium hydride, they have covalent character, they are more covalent. However, other hydrides means the calcium hydride CaH2, strontium hydride SrH2, or barium hydride BaH2, they are ionic in character. The stability of hydrides decreases from beryllium to barium. So stability of these hydrides decreases as we go down the group. So with the exception of beryllium, the alkaline earth metal hydrides react with water to produce metal hydroxides and hydrogen gas. And this thing we can see here. So calcium hydride, it is written here. So other than beryllium hydride, you can have same reaction, type of reaction. So one can write here MH2. Where M can be magnesium, calcium, strontium, and barium. The example that we have taken here is calcium hydride, which is a solid. And when it reacts with water, we see formation of calcium hydroxide plus 2H2. What we see here, it's a calcium cation, calcium ion plus hydride H minus, which is a base. We know H minus is a very strong base, it's much stronger than OH minus and other bases. It's a very strong base, and that strong base, what can it do? Water, we know it's kind of a proteric molecule. It has both basic as well as acidic character. And if base is there, very strong base, that strong base can abstract H plus from water molecule. So the hydride, these hydrides will abstract H plus from water molecules. They are already H minus, and once the H plus comes to them, it will become H2. So the H2 molecule, hydrogen dihydrogen will be formed. And what will be left is OH. Once the H plus is abstracted, OH minus will be left. Hydroxyl ions will be left, and that hydroxyl ions will combine with the calcium to form calcium hydroxide. So one can have, again, this is a double kind of double displacement reaction. So what you can do is here H plus OH minus usually. So the OH minus will come with the calcium positive part of this, and the negative part of this will go with the positive part of the water. So negative part of this compound is what? H minus, and that will go with the H plus, positive part of the water molecule, and so the H2 molecule is formed. Now let us come to see the reactivity towards acid. Usually what we see, all the alkaline earth metals readily react with acids, liberating hydrogen gas, and this we have seen most of the metals, they react with acids to form hydrogen gas. So hydrogen gas is evolved. So the alkaline earth metal salt. So give this reaction usually, but what will happen? This reactivity, their reactivity will depend on their basic character. Or basic character means electropositive character. So as electropositive character increases down the group, so this is their reactivity will also increase down the group. So all forms, all gives hydrogen, liberate hydrogen, release hydrogen on reacting with acid. So all the alkaline earth metals is a general reaction for everyone. However, their reactivity, there is certain trend in reactivity for forming hydrogen gas on reaction with acids will increase as you go down the group. So from beryllium to barium, it will increase. Now let us look at the halides of alkaline earth metals. And halides, we know halides are what? X minus, where X could be fluorine, fluoride, or the FClBrI. So if X minus will be F minus Cl minus Br minus I minus. So these are called fluorides, chlorides, bromides, and iodide. And so in general, that we call halides. So halides means the compounds of halogen, and the compounds of halogens with a metal are called halides. So not only the metals, also with the organic compounds, we call those them halides. So all the alkaline earth metals combine directly with halogen at elevated temperature forming halides. So all the alkaline earth metals from beryllium to barium, they all react with the halogens, but a little higher temperature, not at the room temperature or normal temperature, at the elevated temperature, high temperature, they all directly react with halogens. And halogens, all the kind of halogens, F2, Cl2, Br2, I2, because we know in the naturally chlorine exists as F2, chlorine as Cl2, means they all exist as a diatomic molecules. So, and that diatomic means homonuclear diatomic molecules, because the same nucleus is there, means the same atoms are involved there in this diatomic molecule. There are diatomic molecules which are called heteronucleus. For example, carbon monoxide, carbon CO, is also a diatomic molecule, but it is heteronuclear. NO is a nitric oxide, is also a heteronuclear diatomic molecule. This is a diatomic molecule, heteronuclear. Homonuclear means the same nucleus, same atoms are involved in forming this diatomic molecule. And that is very clear by name itself. So these halides can also be prepared by the action of halogen acids. And halogen acid means the halo acids you can call HX. X could be FClBrI. On metals, so metals can directly react with HX to form metal halide. Or metal oxide can also react with the halogen acids, HX, to form metal halides, the alkaline earth metal halides, or alkaline earth metal hydroxides that are MOH twice, they can also react with the HX to form alkaline earth metal halides, or the carbonates of this alkaline earth metals can also react with the halogen acids to form alkaline earth metal halides. And this is what the reaction that we see here. So metal can react with HX to give MX2, and then the H2 formation hydrogen gas will be formed here, and the metal will provide electron to H, and so two electrons to 2H it provides, and so two hydrogen radicals they combine to form H2, and so metal will become what? It will become 2 plus, and their X minus is already there, and that's 2X minus will combine with one metal, and so it will form this compound, usually any compound other than if the compounds are not of the beryllium. Now the metal oxide, alkaline earth metal oxide, we know oxide has a valency 2, and alkaline earth metals, their valency is also 2. So their formula, the chemical formula is MO, that we can call chemical formula. As I said, it may not be molecular formula. Please remember, one can call this as a empirical formula, but this is not a molecular formula, because MO is not a molecule. If it is an ionic, there is an ionic bond exists between M and O. So one can call it as an empirical formula, and empirical formula that one can call if there is only two different types of atoms involved. However, if the polyatomic anions are there, then this kind of things may create confusion. And this how? Because if you look at the acetate ion is what? It is CH3COO-. So it is C2O2-, and H3 is there. So these kind of compounds, complexes, when they are, you can have empirical formula, I suppose. But that kind of thing we will see later on, so don't worry. since it came to here, I just explained. So this is a chemical formula of this compound. So 2HX when it reacts, the MX2 will be formed and H2O will be there. And since it has just came, one question I have seen once the question was asked, and what is the, in all the allotropes of carbon, why I was explaining this, because I saw that question, and all the allotropes of carbon, which one of the following exists in the molecular form? And there, all the allotropes of carbon that the question it was given was graphite, diamond, and one more option was there, I forgot, and a fullerene was there. Fullerene is what? It is C60. And its structure is like a football, and 60 carbon atoms are involved. So actually, fullerene is the only thing that fullerene is the only allotrope of carbon which exists in the molecular form, because C60 is a molecule. It has a separate entity. C60 molecules, they can have separate existence. However, if you look at the diamond, you cannot tell how many atoms of carbon they will combine to form diamond. Even the 60 atoms can be diamond. Even you take a larger size diamond, that will also be a diamond. A smaller size diamond, even the very smaller size, that they also have all the only carbon-carbon covalent bonds. They do not have any single entity, separate existence. This is all carbon-carbon atoms, and they are bound to the covalent bond. Similarly, in graphites, what we see, there is a layer, and the carbon-carbon bonds are there, like the benzene molecules are arranged over with each other with the covalent bond, removing all the hydrogens. Then you can get one layer of graphite. So there also, you cannot call how many atoms will be graphite. This is all the layer molecules, and there are many layers are arranged over one another to form a complete graphite. So they are not molecular entity. What is the molecular entity? That is only C60, the fullerene. So that is why this thing came into my mind. So these are all the chemical formula, you can say, the chemical formula. And so this MOH twice, metal alkaline earth metal hydroxides plus 2HX. And this 2HX, it forms MX2 again. This is the halide of the alkaline earth metal. And then water molecules, so above this H plus is here, and that H plus combines with OH minus and to form water. And then this is also a kind of displacement reaction. You can see all the cations and anions are actually, they are exchanged between each other. So the exchange is happening, and so these compounds are formed. So the such reactions are not difficult to write, difficult to remember. One, just you have to understand what kind of compounds they are and what kind of reactions they will give, and so you can easily write the products as well. So MCO3 plus 2HX, what we see usually, so this is also displacement reaction. So it will, the MX2 formation will be there, which will be the salt. So halides of all the alkaline earth metals are usually salt if they are ionic. So they are halide salt, MX2, plus what will we get is H2CO3, and H2CO3 is carbonic acid, and what we know, usually carbonic acid is not that much stable, and so it decomposes into carbon dioxide and water. So you can either write H2CO3, that is also okay, but usually what we see, it decomposes into carbon dioxide and water, so the final product is written like this. So thermal decomposition of ammonium tetrafluoroberylate, this tetrafluoroberylate BeF4 single minus, two minus, and beryllium plus two charge of fluoride. Each fluoride has one negative charge, four fluorides. So BeF2 will have two negative charge. So the valency of BeF4, which is a polyatomic anion. So this polyatomic anion BeF4, it has a separate, it is a separate entity, separate existence. There is two negative charge, so its valency. So valency of tetrafluoroberylate anion, that name is given, tetrafluoroberylate anion is two minus, and valency is two. And ammonium, that we know, it's also a polyatomic cation, and it's a polyatomic cation, not anion. This is polyatomic anion, so it has valency one plus one charge is there, and so we just exchange the valency. So this NH4 twice BeF4 is what called ammonium tetrafluoroberylate. Is the base route for the preparation of BeF2. What we see that the BeF2 usually can be formed using this method, but the best way for forming BeF2 fluoride is like this: the use ammonium tetrafluoroberylate and just decompose it, and after decomposition, after heating, what we will see, this ammonium fluoride will be formed, and a BeF2 will also be formed. So ammonium fluoride, so to balance this, we have to do 2NH4F plus BeF2. This is the beryllium fluoride plus ammonium fluoride. And so the, after decomposition, you can see the two cations are there, and both the cations will go with anion. And according to their valency, fluoride has one valency, so one ammonium ion which has one valency, it will react with only one fluorine. So NH4F, this is a polyatomic cation. And now B is dipositive cation. It has two charge, plus two charge and plus two charge. Because of that, it will interact with 2F2, and so 2F2 is there. So BF2 formation will be there. So beryllium chloride is, however, this is about the BF2, and we know beryllium has certain properties which are different than the other metals. So let us also look at the beryllium chloride. Beryllium chloride, however, conveniently obtained from oxides. So beryllium oxide, when it is reduced in presence of carbon and the fluorine gas at a 600 to 800 Kelvin at the elevated temperature, what do we see? We see the formation of beryllium chloride plus carbon monoxide. So carbon, this carbon will extract oxygen from beryllium oxide. So the CO formation will be there, and so this Cl2 will now combine with the beryllium. And thus, what do we see? And the formation of BCl2 plus CO. And what is one important to remember is the BCl2, usually it forms in the solid structure, it forms a chain-like structure in layer, and different layers, like we have seen in the graphite, different layers of graphite are, graphite is arranged over one layer of graphite is called graphene, and so all the many layers of graphene will arrange over each other, so one can see the formation of graphite. Here we also see BCl2 layer is arranged over one another, so the BCl2 solid structure, the state structure we obtain. And so BCl2 is also covalent, and why it is covalent, the region is already explained for the BH2. The same region is here because of the small size and the plus 2 charge, and its polarizing power is very high, and because of the very high polarizing power, the BCl2 is covalent. And the chloride MgCl, other chloride, that means the chlorides of other alkaline earth metals, like MgCl2, CaCl2, SrCl2 or BaCl2 are ionic. Only BaCl2 is covalent, and this is the reason is very high polarizing power of beryllium. And other chlorides are ionic, and the ionic character of chlorides increases as the size of metal ion increases. And their ionic character increases, and why it is increases, that we know the character, electropositive character of metal ion increases, and electropositive character increases, it depends on the atomic and the ionic size of the metal, and that we see the ionic and atomic size increases, so the electropositive character and thus the ionic character also increases. And because with the increasing size of the ionic radius, what we see, the charge to size ratio decreases, and with the decreasing charge to size ratio, the polarizing power of cation will decrease, and polarizing power of the cation will decrease. It means the polarization of the electron cloud of anion will decrease, and the polarization of electron cloud of the anion is decreasing. It means the covalent character of the compounds are in decreasing, and the covalent character is decreasing means the ionic character is increasing, because the covalent character and ionic characters are reciprocal to each other. So something having more covalent character will have or most highest covalent character, means the homo nuclear diatomic molecules, so they're the highest covalent character, so that will have least ionic character, and something have highest ionic character will have least covalent character. Anyway, now let us look at the carbonates of alkaline earth metals. And the alkaline earth metals carbonates are obtained as precipitate when sodium ammonium carbonate is added to the solution. The sodium carbonate or ammonium carbonate, it means sodium carbonate or ammonium carbonate, when they are added to their solution, and usually what we see, this their halide, the chlorides are ionic and they are dissolved in water. So if their calcium chloride, suppose calcium chloride solution is there, the aqueous solution of the calcium chloride, and if you add Na2CO3, means you are adding carbonate ion there. So what can you see, that with the adding carbonate, you can see calcium can also form carbonate with the CO3 minus ions, means it is there in the solution. So in sodium carbonate, it's fully dissolved in the water, and the carbonate ion will be there, sodium ions will be there, calcium ions and the chloride ions. And if you look at now at the KSP, so there is formation of the four product possibility. One is the sodium carbonate, one is the calcium chloride, another is the sodium chloride, and another is calcium carbonate. So in the product, once everything is dissolved, all the ions are separated. So one can have four products, different products, and which product will be formed, it will depend, or the will be precipitated, it will depend on the KSP of all the salts. And if you look at the KSP of all the salts, calcium carbonate in this case, KSP is least. KSP is least means the calcium ion and the carbonate ions, they are there in the solution. They will not like to be in the dissolved form. They will interact with each other, and so the precipitate will form. And so this kind of sodium and ammonium carbonates of this kind of, what we know, they are dissolved in water. And if you add to the solution of alkaline earth metals, it is not only CaCl2, any solution for the calcium ion, you just need to put there the calcium ion in any form. So because of the very low KSP means the solubility product, the formation of calcium carbonate at precipitate will happen, and some compound which has lowest KSP, it will precipitate first, that we know from the ionic equilibrium. And the NaCl is what? It's aqueous means it is actually still Na plus and Cl minus. It's not NaCl and the combined there. Usually it will be in the form of Na plus and Cl minus. Now the ammonium carbonates is ammonium that we know, like sodium ammonium also has plus one valency. So ammonium carbonate plus CaCl2 again, it will build ammonium chloride, which is also ionic. So this ionic character, it's a weak electrolyte, this is also ionic, usually it's a strong electrolyte. And so the calcium carbonate will also be precipitated. In this case, it is also solid, or some the arrow in the downward direction that we put for the precipitate. The sodium carbonate plus BaCl2, similar to calcium chloride, if you also have BaCl2 or SrCl2, strontium chloride, you can have the barium carbonate and strontium carbonate as a precipitate there as well. Because all these carbonates, their KSP value is very low. And why their KSP value is low? Another way to tell is their dissolution in water is very low. They are sparingly soluble in water, and where sparingly soluble in water, it means their KSP value is very low. Because if you put just barium carbonate or calcium carbonate or strontium carbonate and try to dissolve it in water, you'll see very small amount of barium and carbonate ions will be there in the solution. It means having more high concentration of carbonate and barium ion to the solution is thermodynamically not a stable condition. And so it is not being dissolved. And even the same thing, that it is an equilibrium reaction, and we have seen there in ionic equilibrium, that a similar equilibrium can be achieved even if you start with the separate cations and anions. So you just use a barium cation solution and carbonate ion solution, two different solutions, and just mix them, and you will see the barium carbonate formation there. And means the equilibrium for the formation of barium carbonate or the dissolution of barium carbonate can be achieved from both the sides. So either you take products and you can get to the equilibrium, or you can start with the reactants, the water molecules, the free pure water and the carbonate of these metals, and you can go to the equilibrium again. So this now the alkaline earth metal carbonates are obtained as white precipitates. Usually they are white in color, so they are obtained as white precipitate as well in this case. And so similar reaction one can also form with the alternative route. So they are obtained as white precipitate when calculated amount of carbon dioxide is passed through solution of alkaline metal hydroxide. This is one thing, this reaction is very important in also in the when you test the different anions and cations, presence of different cations and anions. So suppose you doubt that there is a alkaline earth metal into the solution and the given salt, and I mean the salt analysis that you will be performing in the laboratories. So if you doubt that there might be the calcium or the alkaline earth metal there, so and if there solution OH minus solution is there, you just pass carbon dioxide and you will see the formation of metal carbonate. Or if you doubt that the carbonates are there and a carbonate has tendency to release CO2 gas, so if you doubt that the carbonate ion is there, so what can you do? Carbonate is there, you can just add this MgOH twice, and you will see the formation of MgCO3. That's again a white precipitate. So if the And if you what we have seen, usually if you add more and more carbon dioxide, so the carbonate will be turned into bicarbonate, and so again that white precipitate that was there, white thing, the turbidity, that will disappear, and because the formation of bicarbonate which is dissolved in water. The solubility of carbonates of these metals decreases down the groove. This is a very important point. Usually what we think about that the ionic compounds, the ionic character increases, their solubility should increase as we go down the group, because also as you go down the group, we expect that the lattice energy will decrease, and not, but the thing is, not only the lattice energy, the hydration energy also decreases. And here in this case, what happens is, if the carbonate is a very large size anion, it's a very large size anion, and when the very large size anion is there, and that as you go down with the carbonates of other alkaline earth metals, though there is a significant change in the ionic radii, but the thing is, in comparison to the very large anion, that change is not that significant. And because that change is not that significant, what happens that the lattice energy is not actually changed to a significant amount. It decreases to a slightly, to a certain amount, it almost decreases, there is a certain trend, but it doesn't change to a significant amount. So one can say it remains almost unchanged. However, the hydration energy, once the cations will be forming, the hydration energy, usually one can see there will be certain change, or the hydration energy of the cations will decrease. Anion is same in all the cases, it is carbonate, so that will not give any difference, that will not give any trend. The trend will be obtained only because of the cations, or their hydration energy, because of the increasing size, it decreases. And so what we see, the solubility of these carbonates decreases as you go down the group. And this trend is not only true for the carbonates, usually for the all large size polyatomic anions with their salt, you see the similar trend, like sulfate. Sulfate is also very large size anion, so you will see same trend that their solubility will decrease. Now, the solubility of the alkaline earth metal sulfates will decrease down the group, again because in that case as well, the lattice energy is not the dominating factor. In the decrease in lattice energy, not the determining or dominant factor. However, the change in the hydration energy is the determining factor, so it decreases because the hydration energy decreases. But if the anions are smaller in size, you will see the reverse trend. Like for the hydroxide, usually alkaline earth metal hydroxides, their solubility increases as you go down the group, because anions are smaller in size, and so their solubility will increase. Usually also it's the case of chloride and others, you see, that means the monoatomic or even the diatomic anion like hydroxyl anions, we see the similar trend. However, if the case of bulkier anion, polyatomic anions, we see the different trend, because in that case, and that how mathematically it comes out to be, we'll see a bit later in a couple of questions. So the solubility of carbonates of these metals decreases down the group due to the decrease of hydration energy, as the lattice energy remains almost unchanged or just changes slightly. The carbonates of these metals decompose on heating to give corresponding oxides, and this kind of thing, and the beryllium carbonate is unstable. So example is beryllium carbonate is unstable, and the carbonate, their thermal stability increases down the group. And why it increases down the group, because what we see, this form, they form oxide, metal oxides. And in the case of alkaline earth metals, we have seen with the lithium carbonate, forms very easily Li2O. And why it is, because the cation size is smaller, the polarizing power is more, and because of the polarizing power, what happens, the lone pair of the electron density of oxygen that is directly interacting with the cation, it will be polarized towards the metal, and so the electron density will be shifted towards the metal, so the electron density will be reduced towards the other part of the polyatomic anion, like the carbonates, the CO2 part, and thus the molecule actually, it clips between one MO and CO2 part. So the MO and CO2 will formation will happen, and as the metal ions size increases, the polarizing power decreases, so that thermal stability also increases. And so the what we see, the beryllium carbonate is unstable. And as we move down from beryllium to barium, thermal stability of carbonates usually increases, and why it is increases because the polarizing power of the metals decreases. And so what you see, the all the most of the regions are because of the polarizing power or something else, on the size, ionic size, or the charge on the cation and anion, their size, that is all give the most of the region, and their trend, how it changes, you can find out actually by by intuition itself. You can answer few of the questions if you see by reasoning. So anyway, let us look at now the nitrides of alkaline earth metals. All the alkaline earth metals directly combine with nitrogen to give nitrides. So they directly combine with the nitrogen, similar to the things that we see for the alkaline earth metals. Only lithium forms, reacts with nitrogen to give nitrides directly. Other alkali metals, we have seen that they do not react with the nitrogen to give nitrides. However, all the alkaline earth metals, they can react like lithium with the nitrogen directly, nitrogen of the air, to give nitrides. And so the metal is there, and when it reacts with the nitrogen, it can form metal nitride. And metal nitride, we know nitrogen has three valency, it's 3-, nitride has three valency and 3-, so that 3 is before the metal, and metal's 2 charge is as a subscript, right, subscript in the for the nitrogen. The ease of formation of nitrides decreases from beryllium to barium, and a similar trend we have seen in the alkali metals as well, because we have seen only lithium forms this. Other alkali metals do not form nitrides. This means that ease of the forming nitride decreases. The similar trend we have seen for the alkaline earth metals. Although they form, all of them form nitride, but the ease with which they form nitride, it decreases as you go down the group. So these nitrides are hydrolyzed by water to liberate ammonia, and a similar reaction we have seen for the alkali metals as well. They also liberate ammonia. So means the lithium nitride, when hydrolyzed by water, it gives ammonia. So the like lithium, what we see, the nitrides of alkaline earth metals also, like lithium nitride, they also hydrolyzed by water to give ammonia as a product. So M3N2 plus 6H2O. So what are the nitrogen reacts with the hydrogen that are there, and the H plus and OH minus, and the OH minus goes with the metal, and whatever the H plus are there, that goes with the nitrogen. So we see 2NH3 because 2 nitrogens are there, and to balance the 2 has come. So actually product is ammonia plus metal alkaline earth metal hydroxide. Now looking at the nitrates of alkaline earth metals. Nitrates are means alkaline earth metal nitrates. So alkaline earth metal nitrates means the nitrates of alkaline earth metals are soluble in water usually, and they are soluble in water. On heating, they decompose into their corresponding oxide, and this property we have seen with the lithium only, because what we saw that other alkali metal nitrates, they give nitrite of alkali metals, like metal NO2 formation happens on heating. But however, lithium, what it gives? Lithium gives Li2O. Here, similar to the lithium, what we see, lithium nitrate, we see the alkaline earth metal nitrates give similar reactions. So alkaline earth metal nitrates also give alkaline earth metals oxide plus NO2 plus oxygen. Similar reaction we have seen for the lithium nitrate. However, other alkali metal nitrates, they give alkali metal nitrite, and nitrite means metal NO2. Now, coming to the action with the carbon usually we see it's a kind of reducing agent. So when alkaline earth metals except beryllium and magnesium, when heated with carbon, form carbides of type MC2. So when calcium, barium, strontium, when they react with carbon, what they do, they form MC2. And this MC2, when MC2 carbide, it's a C, triple bond C, and 2 negative charge on this, like acetylene. Acetylene gas, what you know, HC triple bond CH. So from the acetylene, if you remove 2 H plus ions, what will be there? It will be C2 minus. So this carbide is actually the acetylide. So this is also called acetylide. So this is acetylide. So it's actually metal acetylide. However, beryllium and magnesium can also form carbides, but their chemical nature is different. Beryllium form carbide, which is a kind of covalent compound, and so like carbon forms double bond with two different beryllium. So there is a beryllium double bond carbon, then double bond beryllium. So beryllium has only two electrons, so the sharing of two electrons with the one carbon. One beryllium share two electron with carbon, and then another beryllium also share its two electron with the carbon. So carbon's octet is complete now, but and this is a linear compound, but the and because beryllium doesn't have any lone pair, but this kind of formation happens. However, in the case of magnesium, usually, however, this kind of carbides are also formed in the extreme conditions, but magnesium usually forms a carbide of Mg3C2 type. There it is actually C triple bond C, then CH3 whole to minus. This kind of formation will be happening there. So actually it is C minus, then triple bond C, then CH2 single minus. Actually, this kind of formation is there. You can imagine or you can write while watching this lecture, C, one negative charge on this carbon, then triple bond carbon, then a single bond CH2, and then there will be one negative charge on this carbon as well. So you can similarly write other resonating structures as well if possible in this case. However, you can do some of the resonance structure you can write. So it is kind of C3-2 minus anion, and that C3-2 minus anion is formed with when the carbon reacts with the magnesium. And however, this MC2 type of carbides are formed when calcium, strontium, and barium reacts with carbon. And so these carbides, means carbides of barium, strontium, and magnesium, when react with water, they give acetylene gas. And so acetylene gas is there. So MOH twice acetylene gas. However, in the case of, if you look at beryllium carbide, B2C, because B double bond C double bond B, so B2C, you see the formation of methane because there is only one carbon in that case. However, if Mg2C, it forms kind of propylene gas. That kind of reactions we'll see a bit later. Mg2C3, yeah. So I want to correct this. Mg2C3 is actually this kind of this carbide. C3 is the 4 minus on there, 4 negative charges there. It is actually C single charge, then triple bond C, and then single bond C, and there will be 3 negative charge because all the 3 carbons, like if the you can just give an can take an analogy of propylene gas, which is CH triple bond C single bond CH3. So if you remove all the hydrogens from this propylene gas, whatever will be there, that will be C3-4 minus, and that is the carbide of magnesium. So that is why it will have 4 negative charge. So valency is 4 and magnesium valency is 2. So we need to write this C3-4 minus and Mg2 plus. So the compound is the Mg2C3. And that when Mg2C3, when it reacts with water, so there are 3 carbons, so we get propylene gas as a product in that case. Coming to the sulfates of alkaline earth metals, all the alkaline earth metals form sulfate of type MSO4, and that we know because of the valency sulfate 2 minus, alkaline earth metal 2 plus by the action of H2SO4. So when the alkaline earth with a similar kind of reactions we have seen here for the case of halides as well. So when halides, when this HX is what it is, an acid. So when the halo acid or the halogen acids react with the metal or metal oxide, metal hydroxide or metal carbonate, they are all there basic in nature, and this is acid. So when the bases react with the basic compounds react with the acids, they form salts, and that we see the halo salts or halide salts in this case. If these bases, metal is also alkaline earth metals has basic character, their oxide also basic in nature, their hydroxide and carbonates are also basic in nature. When these metals, their oxide, their carbonate and hydroxides, they also react with the sulfuric acid. This is acid, they are all bases, so that we see the formation of salt again. And how the formation of salt, what we see usually, the anions come from the acid and cation comes from the base. So the anion is from the AC. Similar thing we have seen for the formation of alkaline earth metal halides. So similar reactions you can see. So the metal, which is basic in nature, when react with the acid, it forms metal sulfate and the hydrogen gas will be evolved. And these kind of things for the HCl we have seen as an example. Similar reaction you can see for the H2SO4 as well, because this is all the metals react with usually all the acids and they to liberate hydrogen gas. Now the metal oxide when react with the sulfuric acid, oxide is also basic, so it will form the salt, sulfate salt of metal, and so this is also a double exchange reaction or double displacement reaction kind. So one gets a metal sulfate, SO4 plus H2O formation will be here. So double displacement, the cation and anion, they are exchanged between two different compounds. So MCO3 is also kind of basic salt. This is also a salt, but it is a basic salt. And when this basic salt, when react with the acid, it forms metal sulfate plus water plus CO2, because this is the H2CO3 formation will be here. And then H2CO3 carbonic acid decomposes into water and carbon dioxide. Now the metal hydroxide, and the metal hydroxide when it reacts with this, we know it's a base hydroxide, so usually hydroxyl ions are there. If they are released in the aqueous solution, they'll OH minus ions, they make the solution more basic, increases the pH of the solution, because pH increases because the OH minus ion concentration increases, so H plus ion concentration will decrease, because the concentration of H plus ion and OH minus ions, their multiplication, their product is constant in water, that is 10 to the power minus 14. So if H plus ion concentration OH minus ion concentration is increasing, so the H plus ion concentration will be 10 to the power 14 minus OH minus ion concentration. So the H plus ion concentration will decrease, thus the pH will increase, because pH is negative of log of H plus ion concentration or the hydrogenium ion concentration. So usually these are bases, and when they react with the acid, sulfuric acid, they also form sulfate. So these reactions are also very easy to understand, because you know when the base reacts with the acid, it forms salt, and the salt, in that salt, the anion comes from the acid, cation comes from the base, and whatever is left over from the cation, the anionic part of the base and cationic part of the acid, they will combine together to form other product. And that you see in all the cases. In this case, you may see two products, but that product is nothing but H2CO3, is a single product. After decomposition, it forms this. So like carbonates, the solubility of sulfates in water decreases, and this I have explained while explaining the carbonate. On moving down the group, the region is the same. The beryllium sulfate and magnesium sulfate are fairly soluble in water, while barium sulfate is completely insoluble. So please care, this is beryllium and this is barium. You should not make mistakes between beryllium and barium, should not get confused. Sometimes I do not remember whether while explaining I am already distinguishing between them or not, although I am very careful in explaining this. So this is the beryllium sulfate and that is the barium sulfate. So now the sulfates are quite stable to heat, however reduced to sulfide on heating with carbon. So these sulfates of alkaline earth metals are usually very stable on, means they do not decompose easily on heating, they are very stable. However, they can be reduced when react with the carbon, and so this reduction happens. So the metal sulfide formation and the CO2 gas formation happens. So metal sulfide and this oxygen goes with the carbon, and so the CO2 formation happens, and MS will be there. The sulfur oxygen bond breaks, and the sulfur oxygen, this oxygen goes to the carbon to form carbon dioxide, and MS sulfide will be there. The action with the sulfur and phosphorus, if you look at the action, and what we know, the sulfur and phosphorus, sulfur usually we know it exists as acid, and phosphorus exists as P4 molecules. So the alkaline earth metals directly combine with sulfur and phosphorus when heated to form heated. Alkaline earth metals, when it heated with the sulfur, it forms metal alkaline earth metal sulfide. And when the alkaline earth metal is heated with the phosphorus, it forms alkaline earth metal phosphide. And the phosphide is P3 minus, sulfide is sulfide is H2 minus. So the formula of metal sulfide will be, the chemical formula will be MS, and chemical formula of phosphide will be M3P2, and that we know the valency of phosphorus is below this as a subscript, right subscript to the metal, and the valency of metal is written as a right subscript to the this anion. So what we see, the metal when react with the sulfur, it forms metal sulfide, and the metal when react with the phosphorite, it gives metal phosphide M3P2. One thing you should be careful about is sometimes in somewhere the reactions, they only like the sulfur, metal plus sulfur, it gives MS. So in that case, you have to write this 8 will not be there. So that stoichiometry, you should not get confused that that was a different reaction and this is a different reaction. So just to sometimes people, though that is not a right way, this is a better way to write. And your NCERT book also, what I have seen, M plus S, it gives MS kind of thing, that was there, some of the books. But you should actually, more correctly, you should write N plus S8 as 8MS. And similarly, metal plus P4 forms M3P2, and to balance, we have to multiply this with 2 and the metal with 6. And so metal, this is a balanced reaction now. So the metal phosphide is formed. Sulfides of alkaline earth metals on hydrolysis liberate H2 waste. This is like an important thing, like nitride, what we have seen. Alkaline earth metal nitrides, when they react with water, water can also behave as a dilute acid, because we know water also behave as an acid. So when they react with the dilute water, their nitride, they form ammonia. And because the hydrogen and nitrogen compound here, what we see, the dilute acid, and so the hydrogen dilute acid has H plus ions, and those S plus ions react with this sulfide to form H2S, and the plus salt will also be formed because the acid is there, and that anion will go with the metal plus salt. So the M3P2, this like phosphide, when it also reacts with a dilute acid, and dilute acid, what it forms, the phosphine. This is a phosphine gas. This is a hydrogen sulfide or H2S gas, and this is phosphine gas. Its name is phosphine. This is H2S hydrogen sulfide. They both are gases, and the salt formation will also be there as an additional product. Now let us look at the uses, some general uses of alkaline earth metals. And general usage means there are many other uses of alkaline earth metals as well. Some general uses that we do, that we will be looking at. So the copper, beryllium, usually what we have seen, alkaline earth metals, they form alloys very easily. So that they form alloy means they can go with the other metal. And how it happens, if you just melt two metals, and if they are in the liquid form, in the molten state, then those molten state, and you can just mix these two liquid metals, and then when you mix these two liquid metals and now leave it to crystallize, and what will happen, you will find the alloy of the two metals usually. So the copper beryllium alloy, beryllium form alloy with the copper, and copper beryllium alloy are used for preparing high strength springs. So springs you might be knowing, and so to prepare high strength springs, we use copper beryllium alloy. And how this copper beryllium alloy will be formed? Copper will be melted, so in the molten state, and the molten beryllium we use, we mix them and then allow whatever that will be there, and that alloy you can use for preparing springs. So other use of beryllium is used in the making of windows of X-ray tubes. So X-ray tubes, you know, be used for the different medicinal purposes, and there the windows are made of the beryllium metal. Magnesium forms, like beryllium forms alloy with the copper, magnesium can form alloy with aluminium, zinc, manganese, and tin. And usually alloys are two types that we have seen in the interstitial alloy on the displacement alloy that we see. But as I said, so alloy means the interstitial alloy means what you see, the larger metal, the metal with the larger atomic size, like we see the copper and beryllium. So all the lattice points will be taken by the larger atom with the larger atomic size, and the smaller atom for the metal of the smaller radius, atomic radius, it will sit into the interstitial positions at the different places. So its density will be very high, and strength will usually be high, and that we see the example of copper beryllium. However, if the two metals, their atomic radii of the similar type, what we see the in the one can consider the metal which is in the smaller amount, that will replace the usual lattice points of the metal which is in the large excess. And a similar alloy formation that you can see for the steel as well. So steel, iron, atomic radius of iron is quite large and carbon is very smaller in size. So the carbon takes interstitial position. So the strength of steel is high. Its density also increases because the carbon takes the interstitial positions. And those interstitial positions are nothing but voids that are there into the crystal structure of the iron. And similarly, the copper beryllium that you can see similar kind of alloy formation happens. So two types of alloy we usually see. However, if you look at the magnesium aluminium alloy, there is not much difference in size. So you'll see the displacement type of alloy. So the magnesium aluminium, magnesium can also form alloy with zinc or tin or the manganese. And magnesium and aluminium alloy, and we know magnesium is also a light metal and aluminium is also a light metal, and their alloys also being light are used in making aircrafts. So magnesium, both in powdered and ribbon form, is used in flash powders and bulbs, incendiary bombs and signal. Incendiary bombs means sometimes we use something to ignite something. So these incendiary bombs are something to just use it to ignite some material, and that's why it is used, because it can easily explode and provide heat, and that heat will be used to ignite some other material. So it does the suspension of magnesium hydroxide and what we call the milk of magnesia, MgOH twice. Magnesium hydroxide is what? MgOH twice. Its other name, its suspension in water, is called milk in magnesia, and which is used as antacid. Magnesium carbonate is an ingredient in toothpaste. So toothpaste, you know, you use magnesium carbonate, you might not have noticed, but you use magnesium carbonate there in toothpaste as well. Now coming to the calcium, calcium is used in the extraction of metal from oxides, because usually metal oxides are very robust, they're stable, so they're difficult to be reduced by the carbon. So what we use certain metals like calcium, which has a stronger electron donating tendency, so that can reduce the metal oxides, and from there we can extract metal from those oxides using calcium when carbon doesn't work. Otherwise, carbon is cheaper. And if the carbon works, we use mostly carbon or coke, we call, to reduce oxides of most of the metals. Calcium and barium metals, which react readily with oxygen and nitrogen, are often used to remove air from the vacuum tubes. So the vacuum tubes that are there, and if you use, and in the vacuum tubes, usually what happens, usually some oxygen will be there. And once you use calcium and the barium metals there, this calcium and barium, they will react with the oxygen or nitrogen that is there in the air, and it will form some solid compound that will be calcium oxide or calcium nitride or barium oxide, barium nitride. And most of the space that was occupied by the air will now be left empty. So maximum amount of gas will be removed by using just calcium and barium metal, pure metals. And so it is used in vacuum pumps, vacuum tubes. So radium salts are used in radiotherapy, and radium, one use of the alkaline earth metal that I said, that the radium is radioactive, and radioactive means it can actually radiate alpha and beta particles, alpha and beta rays, and these rays are used on the gamma rays as well, and these rays are used in radiotherapy in the treatment of cancer. Let us now look into some. I think time is over. I should stop here, and we'll see other things in the next class, which will be on the next Saturday.